Hello, can you hear me?
Good.
So welcome everyone to the second event for the Saskatchewan Festival Awards Future Thinkers Speaker Series. First, I'd like to acknowledge the fact that today's event is taking place on Treaty 4 territory, the traditional lands of the Cree and the Soto. This project was also made possible through funding from the Government of Canada. Today's speaker is Robert Blythe. He's the Science Projects Manager at the Canadian Light Source with responsibility for upgrades and additions to the experimental facilities, and his remit includes scientific oversight of their educational programs. Dr. Blythe's scientific career has focused on novel materials ranging from rare earth metals to organic LEDs, with over 100 publications in that field. He's made extensive use of synchrotron facilities in his research, beginning with his PhD work at the UK's Daresbury Laboratory in the 1980s. Dr. Blythe received his PhD in surface physics from the University of Liverpool. He came to Canada after 5 years at the Italian National Nanotechnology Laboratory, and prior to this worked at several international facilities. He joined the Canadian Light Source in 2006 as a beamline scientist and was promoted to his current position in 2009. I'll hand it over to you, Rob.
Hi there. Okay, so my name is Rob and I am not the story. So I'm going to talk about Canadian Light Source, but I'd also like to acknowledge it's great to be here on Treaty 4 territory. It's great to be in Moose Jaw. I grew up on air bases in England. My father was in the Royal Air Force and he used to come here. In fact, I was trying to think through, I think this is the only place on the planet that both of us have visited for work. Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. I was born in Lincolnshire, England. Of all the places in the world, I thought the two of us would end up, this would not have been high on the list. But really, enough about me. So I'm going to talk about the Canadian Light Source. We call ourselves, because we are, the brightest light in Canada now. If you're ever driving towards Saskatoon at night or flying over it, you might have noticed some blue. In the middle of all the city lights, there's this blue thing. And if you look a little closer, it looks like this. And you might think, what is this house of blue light? You might think, what is it? What does it do? Why is it here? Who's it for? And maybe even, why is it blue? All right, so we're here to talk science. The Canadian Light Source, and it's glowing blue. You think, that can't be good. So we'll start with the easy question. Why is it blue? All right, so this is what we look like in daylight. Okay. Actually, we have the largest enclosed space in Saskatchewan. It's inside that building, and it's blue because we set up blue lights around it and pointed at the building, right? And why do we do that? Because we want people to ask, what's the blue thing? We want people to be curious. We want people to know what we're doing. That's one of the reasons I'm here. Okay. So, Canadian Light Source, we make light, the brightest light in Canada. We need to have a little conversation about light. So this is a photo I took from my deck. And you know, I live in Saskatchewan, and sometimes I go home and people ask me, so what's Saskatchewan like? And basically this, okay? Land of living skies and farming. Right? When I first moved here, just over 10 years ago, I was working with a guy who's from a Mennonite farm just north of Saskatoon, and he was trying to tell me a little bit about Saskatchewan and all the things you can see and do here. And he said to me, you should go and see Prince Albert National Park. And I'm like, okay, what's it like? And he said, it's like being in the mountains, only flat. And I'm like, okay, I used to live in Austria, and I've been in the mountains, and I can tell you from first-hand experience, the whole not flat thing is a really big part of being in the mountains. I'm like, okay, this is an interesting place. People look at the world a little differently here. And that's a good thing. And I'll come to why that's a good thing later. Okay, so we need to talk about light. So obviously this is rainbow, right? So light, may or may not know, is a wave. Okay? So what's the different between different colors of light. Okay, so we have all the way on the outside, we have red, moving from yellow and green all the way to blue and eventually violet. And the only difference between light of different colors is the wavelength. And the human eye is an amazing detector of light. Your eye is sensitive to thousands of different colors. Even a small change in wavelength, you can see the difference. Absolutely an amazing device, the human eye. But everybody's eyes are calibrated differently. Everybody sees color a little bit differently, especially this boundary between the green and the blue. Everybody sees that slightly differently. You may have got into an argument with somebody about, is this blue, is this green? You may even remember, before the internet got consumed by, let's just call them current events, there was this thing called the dress. You remember the dress. What color was the dress? That's the wrong question to ask. Science is a lot about asking the right questions. The right question to ask about the dress is, what color does it appear to be to you? Because everybody sees color a little differently. Literally everybody sees the world a little bit differently. But wavelength, it doesn't stop here. So if you go to longer and longer wavelengths, you go past red, you can still sense it. You can't see it, but you can sense it. That kind of light is called infrared. It's heat. Beautiful day today. Go outside, stand in the sun. You can feel the sun on your face. That's you detecting infrared light from the sun. So you go the other way. So let's go to violet, and then we go past violet. What's past violet? Well, you can detect that as well. In fact, it is, I have to be honest, there is one thing that white people do better than anybody else, and that is detect ultraviolet light coming from the sun. So you get something like me, right? You really can't get whiter than me, right? If I'm out in the sun for any length of time, I start to change color, I get burned. Sunburn is caused by ultraviolet light from the sun. It's not the heat that burns you, it's the ultraviolet. And if you make the wavelength even shorter, out here somewhere, you get something else. And this something else was discovered by a German scientist called Wilhelm back in the 19th century. It's like, I found a new form of light, a new form of rays. And I don't know what they are. So we called them, I don't know what these are, rays. Except, of course, he's a German professor, he's an extremely well-trained in math, so he uses the mathematical term for, I don't know what this is. He called them X-rays. That's literally what X-rays mean. It means, I'm a German professor who doesn't know what he's found. Right? So when we say light, scientists use regular words sometimes in unusual ways. One of them is light. Light is not just the stuff you can see, but all the stuff you can't see. Infrared, ultraviolet, X-rays. And we have a Canadian light source. That's what we make. And this is what's inside our building. It doesn't photograph very well because it's so big. Right? We have a giant machine. It's 174 meters in circumference. It's called a synchrotron. It's the only one in Canada for a very good reason. They are ferociously expensive. So you tend to find medium-sized countries like Canada have one. The British have got one, the Italians, the French, the Spanish. The Americans have four. The Americans always have to have more. It's just the way the world works. We have this machine. Well, how do you make all that light? You need a big machine. Well, like this. Okay. Not exactly like this. Right? So this is a NASCAR race. Okay. So let's think about what happens. You're in a car. You're driving really fast. You're going around a tight corner. Well, what can sometimes happen? this slide a little bit. Okay? You slide, you need friction with the road. What does the friction make? It makes noise. That screeching sound, you go around the corner, is friction with the road. So let's go even faster. Let's take these cars, well, we're not going to take cars because they're too expensive. We're going to take electrons, little bits of atoms. We're going to speed them up to the speed of light, as fast as you can possibly go, and we're going to make them go around corners. Okay? And when they go around corners, there's friction. And that friction doesn't make noise now, it makes light. All that light, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, X-ray. So here's what the inside of our building looks like. So what we do, over here, the blue line here, we get our electrons, and we fire them down a long gun that we call a linear accelerator. And they get partway to the speed of light, but if you try and build a linear accelerator long enough to get to the speed of light, you're talking tens of kilometers, and real estate's kind of expensive for Saskatoon, so that's not gonna happen, okay? So what you do is you take it, and this blue line, you put it in the purple thing. The purple thing is a racetrack. Shaped accelerator called a booster. And we have them go round and round and round and round, faster and faster and faster until they get to the speed of light. And then we put them in the blue thing and we leave them in there. And if you look close, you can see, first sight, the blue thing looks like a circle. But it's not. It's like a NASCAR track. NASCAR tracks have straightaways and turns. We have what we call straight sections of bends. When you go around the bend, you make light. And we take the light and we send it down pipes that we call beamlines. And each beamline does something different. It takes a different part of the light, or it takes a different shape of the light. It does a different kind of experiment. Or put it another way, each beamline looks at the world in a different way. That's good. The Canadian Light Source has been called the Swiss Army Knife of Science. And I know that's true because I've read it on Wikipedia. And why is it like the Swiss Army Knife? Swiss Army Knife, you can imagine folding out all the tools you can get in there. Right? It's a cool gadget to have. Where that kind of doesn't work is, imagine if the Swiss Army Knife, every tool you unfolded was the best possible type, the best kind of knife, the best kind of screwdriver, the ultimate bottle opener. That's what this is. So you can make all those kinds of light in a different way. You've probably been to hospital, had an X-ray, somebody pointed an X-ray machine at you. Why build this terrifyingly expensive machine in the first place? Well, there's lots of reasons. I could talk about polarization. I could talk about tunability. I could talk about coherence. I could talk about time structure. And that's all true. And those are words that I really don't have time to explain today, but it really comes down to one thing. Power. So two of our beamlines are actually right parallel next to each other. And this is a photo we took when we were first testing them out, right? And like all machines, when you're testing them out, it's like, let's see what this thing can do. Let's turn the dial all the way to the depth, right? So this is a beam of X-rays coming out of two parallel beam lines, okay? And what is that? What is this jet of blue flame coming out, okay? I already told you, you can't see X-rays. So what are we looking at? You've been to a hospital, you've had an X-ray, if somebody pointed an X-ray machine at you and that came out of it, you'd be like, you know, it doesn't hurt that bad, it'll be fine, I'm out of here. Right? So what's actually happening is X-rays are coming out and they're going to the air and they're stripping all the electrons off the air. They're what we call ionizing it completely, making a plasma. And the plasma is de-exciting by giving off blue light, right? It's kind of like the northern lights. It's pretty much the same process as you get with the northern lights. Now, my boss has a flair for the dramatic, and he refers to these as death rays, because he doesn't seem to worry about scaring the general public. Right? The beamline scientist who's in charge of this prefers a different term. Right? This is light. It will cut you. If you were to stand in front of that, you'd get quite badly hurt. So it's light that can cut you. It's a lightsaber. So you've got incredible intensity of X-rays. You can see way smaller things, way tinier things than with a conventional X-ray. But look at this. This is a terrible picture. Let's be honest here. Right? This is not your high-def, whatever type of photo. There's all these little speckly things. Because what's happening is sometimes an X-ray will come out, it'll hit an air molecule, then it bounces. Right? X-rays can bounce. And they bounce into the camera and they start destroying the camera. So this is the camera that's taking this picture being destroyed by X-rays that are just bouncing off air. Right? It is incredibly powerful in every sense of the word. This is the one piece of scientific data I'm going to try and explain to you today. There is some science in this talk, we can't really avoid it. There is no math. Feel free to supply your own. So this is a sample being looked at by an X-ray. And yes, we can do X-ray imaging, but we can find out what's in samples by changing the wavelength of the X-ray and watching what happens. So this is a sample. I won't tell you what it is. And with this technique, we can see what elements are present in the sample. So you can see, okay, it's a lot of oxygen, it's a lot of silicon, it's quite a lot of iron, aluminium, and we are not going to get into a discussion about how to pronounce that. Lots of other things. Tiny, tiny, tiny amount of nitrogen. So you can see what's in there. But these shapes mean something. If you were to zoom in, you can see not just what elements are present, what's that chemical form? Is this iron hydroxide? Is it iron metal? Is it iron chloride? What kind of iron is this? You can answer that question. So you can see really small things, you can see really big things. You can see what elements are present, you can see the chemistry that's going on inside your sample. And this sample is soil. Specifically, this is soil from Saskatchewan. And there's a lot of iron in Saskatchewan soil. It's actually really rather famous for it. It's one of the reasons the soil here is so dark. When I first got here, I saw a freshly tilled field, but I thought it had been burned. The soil is so dark. It's a fantastic tool. And we do literally thousands of experiments per year. We've been running for 10 years. So I was asking my people, what should I talk about when I go to Moose Jaw? And we do all kinds of science, physics, there's chemistry, there's biology, there's pharmacy, veterinary medicine, human medicine, archaeology. We've even had a social scientist come in and study us. Not so much fun. Right? So what should I talk about? And people said to me, you should talk about agriculture because farming is kind of a big thing here in Saskatchewan. So here we run into a problem, which is, I'm not a TV scientist, I'm a real scientist. Scientists on TV know everything about everything, often in amazingly tedious detail. Right? I'm a real scientist, so I know an awful lot about things you probably aren't interested in, really a huge amount, and a bit about most of the rest, and a big hole. Right? I'm not a biologist. I'm a physicist. I don't even have high school biology. And I'm supposed to talk about agriculture science. Okay. So we're going to do that. I'm going to show you three examples. And what I want you to think about is not the details of what I'm showing you, because I really want to understand it. Chances are, you have people here from farming communities understand way more than me. What we want to look at, what is science? Science is all about, it's not about knowing things. It's about asking questions to learn things that help you solve problems. So we're going to look at three examples. We're going to say, what are we trying to learn? What problem are we trying to solve? First one. Well, here, we're actually using some imaging. We're looking inside wheat. And we're trying to figure out, I have no idea what scab is. I'll be honest with you. It sounds bad. If somebody says to me, my wheat field has scab, I'd be like, that sounds terrible. I'm assuming it's a bad thing. But some wheat is obviously resistant to scab. So what we're trying to figure out is why. If we figure out why wheat is resistant to scab, we can stop this scab disease affecting wheat. What we're working on here is the problem that crops get diseases. And you have to fight these diseases. In order to fight the disease, you have to understand what the disease is doing to the plant and why. And you can do that with a synchrotron. So, looking at plant diseases. Here's another one, right? We also have D-stove here. Here's a picture of peas, right? I'm English, we love our peas. This is important to us. So, what are we looking at here? What effect does changing temperature have on the yield of peas, and what's the chemistry behind it? So what are we looking at here? Climate change. We're trying to figure out, what if it gets warmer in Saskatchewan? What difference is that going to make on plant growth? What do we do about it? What if it gets colder? What if it gets wetter? What if it gets drier? I'm going to talk about drought a little later. Right? So we're looking at how changing climate affects crops. And then, of course, maximizing crop growth. This is all about fertilizer, understanding how fertilizers actually work. In this case, phosphorus. What we're trying to do here, understand how fertilizers work, understand how they increase crop yields to help us develop better fertilizers. We've got to keep on feeding people. And we might have to change the fertilizer because the climate is different, or because diseases are new and different. Everything ties it together, right? This is one thing. So that's three examples. So we have this fantastic machine that can do amazing things in all fields of science, and it's in Saskatchewan. Why is it in Saskatchewan? Well, it's a long story. You know what? It seems we have a little time. And we're in a library. So a different doctor once said, stories are memories go when they're forgotten. And if you think about it, libraries are where stories go so they don't get forgotten. So this is a good place to tell a long story. But I have to figure out where to start. So this is February, year 2000. That's our building under construction. In the background is the Agriculture Department of the University of Saskatchewan. Okay. So we sit on their campus. We're not part of it. I don't work at the university. Why is it here? Where do I start that story? Well, I could start it on July 1st, 1867, with a Canadian light source, Canada. I could start there. Right? And obviously, July 1st this year, it's going to be a big deal. When you think of all the history, all the personalities involved, and you think riders, bombers, first competitive game in a new stadium, well, who isn't excited for that? Oh, yeah, and 150th anniversary of Confederation. So we could start there, but I'm not the right person to tell that story. I'm not Canadian, I'm not from here, so let's not start there. So let's skip ahead. 1876, the signing of Treaty 6. Saskatoon's on Treaty 6 territory. And what treaties do is they give Canada, they give the Crown, the right to bring in settlers. Immigrants. They're going to be immigrants in this story. But you want to talk the treaties? Hey, let's get a white guy from England to talk about the treaties. That'll work. Yeah, okay. No, that's not going to work. So we'll skip ahead. 1882. one of these settlers, a guy called John, is looking for a place to start a settlement. And he talks to a local First Nations chief who says, how about the place where all those berries grow, next to the fast-flowing river? And if you say that phrase, place where all the wild berries grow, next to the fast-flowing river in Cree, and then simplify it, I'll be honest here, dumb it down so that idiot English speakers like me have a chance with a bit of practice to say it right, it comes out as Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. That's literally what it means. But I'm not from Saskatoon. Their story is not my story, I'm the only person to tell that story. So we're not going to start there. Let's skip ahead. 1905, formation of the province of Saskatchewan, followed closely by the University of Saskatchewan. And the university is in this picture, it's part of the story. But I'm not from Saskatchewan. You don't invite me here from England to tell you about Saskatchewan. That makes no sense. I don't work for the university. So I've got to start somewhere. 1932. I'm going to start 1932 because 1932, there's an English scientist called John living in Saskatoon. Like me. 1932, though, times are really tough in this province. Really tough. Right? The world economy, well, in today's language, we call it a disaster. Okay? Wheat prices have completely collapsed. Not only that, there's a drought starting. It doesn't really get bad until 1934, but it's going to be really bad. The dirty 30s. Low wheat prices, terrible yields, nobody's making any money. People are going bankrupt, people are leaving the province. And that's a problem for the provincial government because they're getting no revenue. Nobody's paying taxes because nobody's making any money. So teachers aren't getting paid. There's no money to pay teachers. The province funds the university. The university doesn't have enough money to pay its staff. So they say to all the unmarried professors, here's $500, go somewhere else. Oh, and not on top of your salary, that's it. Now poor old John, he's just starting his career, he's not married, he's thinking, yeah. What's he going to do? Where am I going to go? They think, okay, think of this as an opportunity. Where are you going to go if you're a scientist in the early 1930s? You want to go where the best science is being done. Let's use this opportunity. 1930s, center of the world for science, Germany. Got to go to Germany. People forget the extent to which Germany was the cultural center of Europe and arguably of the planet all the way up until the 1930s. Literature, opera, music, science, Germany. So he started writing letters and he found a guy called Gerhardt, who was a young professor in Germany. And the story goes, Gerhardt says, I got this letter from somewhere called Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. Where on earth is that? Nobody's ever heard of it. Not the scientific sense. And he says, well, I've got space in my lab, he can come over and work with us. So John went over to work with Gerhardt in Germany. Right? Very successful, they got on great. And when his time was done, John came back to the University of Saskatchewan. And Gerhardt's left in Germany. And this is a bad time for Gerhardt. At 1933, the German government passed a law with a very boring title, something about the revitalization of the civil service. Part of the government's plan, and I wish I wasn't making this up, to make Germany great again. And in today's language, we wouldn't use that term about the law. We'd probably call it a Jewish ban. And Gerhardt's not Jewish, but his wife is. He's got to get out. Lots of scientists in Germany were either Jewish or had Jewish wives, Jewish grandfathers. They had to get out. And where do you go? Now you don't think, I need to go where the best scientists are. I just need to go somewhere. Somebody please take me in. piece of work. And many of them, the big famous people, didn't have any problems. Albert Einstein turns up and says, can I work here? He goes, yes. And Albert Einstein had to leave Germany. So all the big famous universities, that's where the famous people went. Gerhard, where's he going to go? Saskatoon. He's got friends. And the University of Saskatchewan agrees, they give him a 2-year contract. Come and work with us. So he moves to Saskatoon. So you have John and Gerhard. They're in the physics department, and they start building the physics department. They use what came out of Germany. They start building the physics department of the University of Saskatchewan to be one of the best physics departments in Canada. And eventually people take notice, and people thought, well, have a look at Gerhard. Say, this guy's a rising star, we want him. John was a rising star, but he wanted to stay here. He ended up being the head of the physics department and eventually the president of the university. Gerhard ended up at the National Research Council in Ottawa, where he won the Nobel Prize in 1971. So they need to recruit somebody to replace him. And now this is a place, starting to be a place where people want to go. So they recruited a guy called Leon to replace Gerhard. Leon was Polish, but from somewhere in what is now the Ukraine. And I haven't checked Twitter since I started talking, so I don't know if it's still. So Leon comes to Saskatchewan. And he's a nuclear physicist, and he starts to build up a reputation of this department's really good at nuclear physics. What it doesn't have is the big equipment you need to do nuclear physics. And he says, we need a particle accelerator. We need a linear accelerator to be competitive. And he applied for a research grant to the National Research Council, and by this time, Gerhard is the head of the National Research Council. So they get their money. So this is Leon and his machine, the linear accelerator. And I've already told you about this part of the machine. When I showed you at the beginning the long gun that gets part way to the speed of light, that's this machine. It's still there. It's nearly 50 years old. It's still working. So when 1996, Canada decided we're going to build a synchrotron, finally the last major industrial country to have one of these amazing machines. They decided it should go here. Here's where the people are who understand particle accelerators. They've already got part of the equipment that they need. So the synchrotron ends up in Saskatoon. I remember when it was first announced Canada was going to build a synchrotron. I was living in Austria. And they announced it was going to be in Saskatoon, and I thought, having been to the prairies in winter, they're really going to struggle to get people to go work there. And here I am. So who's it for? Science is about asking the right questions. This is the right question. Who's it for? Well, this is our staff. Right? Roughly 200 of us. And something you might have noticed about all the scientists I've mentioned so far. Wilhelm, and John, and Gerhard, and Leon. They're all guys. So why is that? Well, so back in the 20th century, there was this idea a woman's place is in the home. That persisted quite a long time. When I first started using the British synchrotron in the 1980s, they had two accommodation blocks, the new one and the old one. The old one did not have any women's bathrooms. Because why would you need women's bathrooms? Because this building is for scientists. So you start to think, what's wrong with that picture? Science is about solving problems that matter to society. Why would you take half the population and say, we don't need you? That's ridiculous. 1996, when the Saskatchewan Accelerator Lab finally closed down and became the Canadian Light Source, there was exactly one woman working in the building. And I'm sure you can guess what she did. She was the secretary. We think differently now. We have this, what in the 20th century, completely outlandish idea. If you want to do the best science, we need the best people. Not the best, the best people. First synchrotronic Canada, we need to import a lot of people. So if we're importing people and we're recruiting the best people we can find, diversity is what happens. So we have a lot more women than the Alta Saskatchewan Accelerator. Although in fairness, I should point out, not all the women in this photo are scientists. There are still other jobs that women do. So these three ladies in the front here, they're not scientists at all. No, they're engineers. We have a lot of engineers. We have this enormous set of particle accelerators, and you have to keep them maintained, you have to build them, and if you go to Canadian Tire, there is no aisle marked particle accelerator box. Not even available on their website. You go and make it yourself. So you need engineers. So we have a lot of engineers. A lot of people from all around the planet have now come to Saskatoon to talk about science. But is it for them? Here's a funny thing about us. Most of the science done in our building is not done by our staff. It's done by scientists from all over the world. So this is a map showing where scientists came from in 2016 to use the Canadian language. Obviously they came from across Canada, they came from across the world, they came from an awful long way across the world. And they're coming to Canada. So we are bringing in scientists from all over the world to help us solve the problems that are important to Canada and everybody who lives there. And there's a huge advantage in getting people who look at the world really differently to work together. So this slide is to remind you to tell another story. So it's hard to find your way around our building. It's really complicated. We have direction signs. We have our incomprehensible names for beamlines, it doesn't matter what they stand for. We have the word beamline at the top in both official languages, because we're the Canadian light source, and one other language. I always do a fun thing with guests who bring around the building, guess what that language is? I'm not going to try and say it. As you might have noticed, if you look closely, there are symbols in there that do not exist in the Latin alphabet. The question mark without a dot is not a typing error. That's a sound that doesn't exist in any European language. Because this is Dene. We had a group of Dene-speaking scientists came and worked in our building, and they taught us how to say beamline in their language. Well, they taught us to write it. Don't get me trying to pronounce the name. Saskatoon, Saskatchewan is as far as I can get with Indigenous languages. So, this is to remind me to tell the following story. So, I like, when I go places, try and learn a bit of the local language. I lived in Italy, Germany, Austria. And when I came here, I thought, well, it'd be fun to try and learn some Cree. It's a completely different language, right? And the University of Saskatchewan does evening classes in Cree, so I'm like, I can leave the TLS, I can go over and learn some Cree, that would be great. And at one point, we're doing adjectives. And I asked the question, okay, when are we going to do colors? Because as you remember, color is kind of important. My color is wavelength. And the instructor said, we're not going to cover color, this is an introductory course. It's too hard for beginners, because in Cree, color is a verb, a doing word. So if you think back to that rainbow, light isn't green, it's greening, or it's doing green. And that doesn't even make any sense in English. So I'm like, okay, now I have a headache, because when I think about it, that means wavelength. It's a verb. That's my word. One of the things about our building is we run 24/7. People come from all over the world. We're not going to turn the machine off just because it's dark. Okay? So I went back into the building. I need to find some scientists, so I went to the coffee lounge. And we're a science lab, so the coffee lounge has a whiteboard. I'm like, okay, people, I want you to quickly write down, if we get a beam of x-rays, we point it at the sample, what happens? What are all the physics? So we wrote down a bunch of stuff. And I said, okay, now I want you to take on board the following concept. Wavelength is a verb. And immediately people start thinking, oh, the wavelength change when it goes through the sample. There'll be vibrational measurements. And they wrote down a whole bunch of other stuff that can happen when an x-ray beam hits the sample. So suddenly, we've come up with a better description of what goes on in our building because we introduced exactly one concept from an indigenous language. We've introduced a concept from people who look at the world in a different way. And we're all trying to solve problems. So if you take me and clone me, you don't get any extra ideas on how to solve problems. You need somebody different. So diversity is something we promote not because we're nice people, but because it's important to get our work done. Okay, so go back to that question, who's it for? It's not for our staff. It is for scientists from around the world. Another group of scientists. I'm going to show you some pictures. These are pictures of people working on it. So this is a scientist. She's putting her sample inside the beam light. Right? She's got gloves on because she doesn't want to contaminate the sample. We're sensitive to everything. If you get a little bit of finger grease on your sample, you're going to be measuring that instead of your sample. Right? So this is a scientist putting her sample in one of our beam lights. Here's another scientist, right? What he's doing, he's using liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is incredibly cold. He's making his sample cold. He wants to investigate how his sample behaves when it's really cold. Because sometimes in Saskatchewan, it gets really cold. Right? And he's wearing the appropriate protective equipment so he doesn't get hurt, which is one of the reasons I like this story. Right? So here's another three scientists, just kind of chilling out. They've been using the beamline computers. You can see in the back, I can take data. The light is so bright, she has to wear sunglasses. And here's another group of students. They're in the laboratory. They're having a good time. So these last four pictures. The thing that's different about all these scientists is they're high school students. We were the first, and still pretty much one of the only synchrotrons on the planet, that lets teenagers play with millions of dollars worth of equipment. We've had getting close to 1,000 high school students come into our building, use our equipment, they design their own experiments, and they find out what life is really like as a scientist. But it's not like high school science, it's not like TV science, it's different. And in fact, you've seen some of their work already. The group of scientists who came in who spoke the name were high school students. They were from the school in La Loche, that you may have seen in the news. They were a lot of fun. One of my favorite ever groups of students I've ever worked with. And that data I showed you right at the beginning, the soil sample with all the elements, that was the first data we ever took with a high school group. It ended up in a textbook. The thing we didn't expect is that the high school scientists would come in and do real science that people would be interested in. So who's the Canadian Light Source for? For Canadian students. We've had to recruit people from around the world because we don't have the expertise here. We're growing it. We want the next generation of scientists to be working on building to be from. So, finally, a slide with some words on it. Right? Which means I'll probably remember what I'm supposed to say. Right? So, like every company, we have a vision statement. So, let's take a look at our vision statement. So, delivering innovative solutions. The solution is, well, fixing a problem. That's what we do. We do it innovative. We're cool. Bang, we got this big machine. Right? A leading center for research excellence. We want to be globally famous. We want people from all over the world to come here and help us solve our problems. Right? And then you think, we've got four main research areas. We can do a lot of stuff, we focus on four. So I'll go back to that question. Who is the Canadian license for? Do you have any diseases you'd really like to see go away? Health. We have people from all over the world coming to the Light Source to work on curing diseases that affect Canadians. If you're interested in seeing disease go away, the Canadian Light Source is for you. Agriculture. Are you interested in seeing better fertilizers? Crops that can handle climate change and drought. We have people from all over the world working on that. Are you interested in eating food? I'm interested in eating food. You probably guessed that one. So if you're interested in food and agriculture, Canadian Light Source is for you. Are you interested in the environment? Do you have any concerns about what's in your drinking water? What is resource extraction doing to the environment? What's the oil sands doing to the farm? Do you want to see batteries that can run your pickup truck for an entire year on one charge? We have people from all over the world coming to Saskatoon to work on that. If you're interested in those things, Canadian Light Source is for you. Advanced materials. People interested in the next big thing, tech-wise. You interested in lightweight, durable materials so when you crash your pickup truck, nobody gets hurt. You interested in new kinds of aircraft materials. Maybe you know somebody who works at the airbase. You're interested in those things, an analyte source is for you. So to summarize, we have this amazing machine. We have people coming from all over the world, and what they're doing is solving problems that are important to Canada and everybody who lives here. It's not for them. Canadian Light Source is for you. So I'm going to end with an invitation. We're a very open facility. There's some leaflets at the table in front. Come visit us. Tour us. If you know any teachers or students who want to take part in our education program, come talk to us. We'd love to see people from Moose Jaw. Come visit us, because the Light Source is here. My name is Rob, and my talk is done. Anybody want to ask any questions? I'll be around for a little bit longer anyway. It was good seeing you. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Blythe, for coming today and speaking to us, coming down all the way from Saskatoon. Thanks also to the Moose Jaw Public Library for the use of the theater and the Government of Canada for funding the project. If you're interested in learning more about what Dr. Blythe is talking about today, like you said, there's some pamphlets out on the table there, and there's also some from the Saskatchewan Science Centre in Regina. Our next event in this series will take place on Thursday, March 16th, with writer, naturalist, activist Trevor Harriet. Watch the Saskatchewan Festival Awards website for updates. Thank you for being a great audience, and have a good day.